It was a cold night in Paris, the autumn breeze of 1794, whisking past the violinist on the balcony of his dingy flat, just on the outskirts of the city. As he played his violin, he could see a flickering glow in the distance far ahead. His roommate, Lestat de Liancourt, swore to him that those were the fires of inspiration. But he knew better. Most likely they were the candlelights in the windows of a country village. Provence, he assumed.
Nikki!
Lestat called from the bottom of the stairs that led to their attic apartment.
I have exciting news!
He heaved, which made the violinist stop playing and turn his head toward the inside. To save money on oil for their lamps, he kept the doors of the balcony open and let the moon illuminate their shared small space. His blonde roommate huffed as he placed a large satchel on their small wooden table, fumbling to open it with an excited little bounce.
Exciting news, hmm?
The violinist rolled his eyes fondly at Lestat's childish glee.
Please tell me your father has passed, had a miraculous change of heart, and has left you all of his funds so we can actually get out of this dump.
It is not a dump,
Lestat insisted with a little huff.
True, it's not ideal, but it's a first step. All artists have them.
I'm sure,
Nikki replied, not looking convinced at all. He took a step forward, lowering his violin and entering the apartment.
What have you got there?
Firstly,
Lestat pulled out a baguette and a small bottle of wine.
I've brought dinner.
Since they arrived in Paris, meals were few and far between. Nikki didn't have very much luck finding a job, and playing on the streets didn't bring in many livres. Lestat worked at a theater in the Temple du Boulevard, but only as a stagehand. Together, they barely made enough to pay their rent.
Lestat, I know you mean well.
The blonde put his right index finger on Nikki's lips to silence him.
Nicolas de l'Enfant, I will not hear another word. You don't have to scold me tonight because I was not spending our savings. I went in earlier this week to make sure the pay would be a little heftier.
We share a bed. How did you-
You're a heavier sleeper than you think, mon cher.
Lestat replied with a shit-eating grin, leaning in to kiss his companion's cheek, before he put his satchel down and hurried over to their cabinet to grab glasses for them. Nicholas sighed before he knelt down by their bed, taking the case for his instrument out from under it and putting the violin away.
You said firstly. What's the rest of this exciting news?
Well?
Lestat twisted open the wine bottle and poured a glass for Nicholas.
As we both know, when wine is drunk, we must toast to a success. It just so happens that I have a success to share. As I was cleaning the rows in the audience, I just so happened to overhear a conversation between my employer and the maestro. The maestro was expressing distress over the fact that his violinist quit. And I, being oh so kind, decided to mention that I know a very talented violinist who just might be able to solve his problem.
Nicholas's dark brown eyes widened at Lestat's words, and he immediately put the wine glass his friend passed him down on the table to throw his hands around Lestat and squeeze him close. The blonde nearly spilt his own drink, his arms a bit wide in surprise as Nicholas clung to him.
Well,
Lestat chuckled with surprise at his companion's actions.
Who are you and what have you done to my stoic as stone Nikki?
Femme la,
Nicholas said softly as he gave Lestat a light, affectionate squeeze.
Thank you, Lestat. Thank you so much. I don't know what else to say.
Shh.
His friend replied, cheeks dusted with a faint shade of crimson as he placed his glass down and returned Nicholas's embrace.
You don't have to thank me. I told you our dreams were going to come true. Just took a little time. Once the maestro hears you play, I know he'll take you into the orchestra. And then we'll get to work together. Before you know it, you'll be the star violinist and I'll be on the stage. Lead actor of every play.
Nicholas couldn't hold back his laughter at Lestat's dreams of the future. A beautiful sound the blonde had missed since they moved to Paris. The dark-haired violinist even dared to pick up Lestat a bit and gave them a little spin with delight.
Nikki!
Lestat exclaimed, his hands moving to the other man's shoulders.
Careful, mon ami. I don't think the floor can handle both our weight at once.
Nicholas gave another chuckle, his eyes locked on Lestat's before he closed the space between them in a kiss.
Merci, mon chanson,
he said softly, slightly breathless as their lips parted. He kept his forehead against Lestat's, nuzzling his companion's nose with the tip of his own.
Not just for this opportunity, but for everything. I think I would have lost my mind by now without you.
Give me time. I think I can get you there,
Lestat said with a wink as he slowly moved back, his hands sliding down to rest on Nicholas's chest. He pecked his lover's left cheek before taking his hands in his own.
Now come on! Let's eat while the wine is still cold.
Nicholas nodded, and the two sat at the table, finishing the bottle of wine and half the baguette within the hour. It seemed that things were finally looking up for them. Their father's words of discouragement and the slowness of their progression in Paris didn't matter anymore. All that mattered to Lestat was Nikki, in seeing that beautiful smile once again. He vowed to himself that night, as he laid in his lover's arms, to do whatever he needed to, moving forward to keep Nicholas smiling. Suddenly, the closed doors of the balcony burst open against their hinges towards the inside of the flat. Lestat and Nicholas sat up in bed immediately to see a large, shadowy figure standing on their balcony, its two widespread wings blocking out the light of the moon. Nicholas hurried to reach for the flintlock pistol he kept hidden in their nightstand, but the creature on the balcony launched itself toward the bed. It knocked Nicholas to the right, the young man sliding across the wooden floor to hit the wall by the balcony. Before Lestat could escape the bed, the figure wrapped its long, bony fingers around his throat. It leaned in, a puff of its hot, foul-smelling breath misted against Lestat's left cheek.
My wolf killer.
It snarled in an animalistic growl. Lestat opened his mouth to try and cry out, but the creature squeezed on his throat to make any air he readied choke back down. It leapt out of the bed and moved its grip to Lestat's right arm, its claws digging in and bruising the flesh as it dragged him behind.
Nikki!
Lestat cried out hoarsely, reaching out to his disoriented friend. Nicholas's eyes widened as he realized what was happening and immediately moved to snatch Lestat's hand with both of his own.
Don't let me go, please!
The blonde begged, tears running down his face as he felt his grip slipping.
I don't want to die! I don't want to die, please!
You aren't going to die! I've got you! Nicholas tried to hold on, but in seconds, the creature spread its wings, and the force of it leaping off the balcony was too strong for Nicholas to hold on.
Lestat!
He cried, nearly falling off the balcony, and his hand reached out towards the blonde, who screamed for him as he was being carried away by the demonic beast. A flash of darkness, the cold dampness of a stone tower, the stench of hundreds of rotting corpses, the surging pain of a bite to the neck. Lestat's pleas echoed in the darkness. The decaying hands of the corpses surrounding him began to grip every part of his body they could get a hold of, pulling him down to join them.
Somebody, please! Save me!
Lestat! The vampire Lestat opened his eyes when he heard his name, jolting upright and breathing heavily. He was surprised he hadn't hit his head on the coffin, but he realized shortly that the lid had been open. His fledgling, Louis de Pontoulac, was on his knees by Lestat's coffin. He placed a gentle hand on the blonde's left shoulder.
Hey, you're all right, mon cher. Just a bad dream is all.
Lestat was stunned for a moment, his bright blue eyes darting from left to right, trying to simultaneously process his surroundings while making sure there was no hidden threat. When his breathing slowed, he gave a short nod, resting his hand over Louis's.
Yes. Just a bad dream. Je suis désolé.
Louis's lips curled up in a small smile, shaking his head before he interlocked his fingers with Lestat's and raised his knuckles to his lips, giving them a light kiss.
You don't need to apologize, Lestat. You sounded like you were really going through something. You shouldn't have to deal with that alone.
Lestat felt the blood he had drank earlier that evening moving to his cheeks at the combination of Louis's words and his kiss.
You are truly my savior, Louis de Pontoulac.
Lestat hummed, gazing at his fledgling with as much adoration as a single gaze could manage.
You're such a sap.
Louis rolled his eyes fondly, his thumb tenderly grazing along Lestat's knuckles.
You good to go back to bed? I suppose.
Lestat said, slowly beginning to release his hold on Louis's hand before hesitating.
But you know what would really prevent my sleep from being interrupted a second time?
He looked up at Louis with his best puppy dog eyes, a small pout on his pink plush lips. Louis sighed softly with a shake of his head.
Quit it with that and scooch over already.
Lestat smiled and did as he was told, scooting to his right to allow Louis room to climb into his coffin. When Louis laid beside him, Lestat wrapped his arms around his lover with a contented purr, resting his head against Louis's forehead.
Bonne nuit, mon saint Louis.
Good night, Lestat. I got you.